Good morning, students. So today's topic is pathogen defense strategies, and I welcome all of you to this lecture. So in this lecture, we will be talking about the different strategies that are opted by different class of pathogens so that they can evade the host body or host immune system. The main learning objective of this lecture is to, first of all, we need to understand the detailed information. We need to have a detailed information about what is immune evasion. After that, then what are the contributing strategies, or what are the strategies that are opted by a pathogen so as to evade the host immune system, so as to provide them protection against various host defense mechanisms. So at the end of this lecture, you will be getting to know the concept of immune evasion, the various mechanistic approaches that are undertaken by specific pathogens so as to provide them protection, or you can say so as to evade the host immune system. So the first point is, first of all, we must know what is immune evasion. Immune evasion, basically, it is a mechanism in which the immune system, or immune responses, or the arms of our immune system, they are being evaded or they are broken by different type of pathogens. So what are immune evasion strategies then? Now, the immune evasion strategies are those strategies which are opted by either bacterial pathogens, virus, fungal pathogens, so as to avoid or to inactivate the host defense. That means every body have a particular defense system that comes in the form of immune mechanisms. For example, whether it is innate immunity or adaptive immunity. So whenever a particular pathogen, they use certain mechanistic approaches to avoid the host defense or to inactivate the host defense so that their own survival can be, you know, very smooth inside the host. So those are known as immune evasion strategies. Because there are all of these pathogenic microorganisms, they basically modify themselves, or you can say they undergo many changes in a various ways, so that they can either bypass the immune mechanism of the host body, or they can overcome the different immunological defenses imposed by the host. So because of that, the virulence of the host is basically, or you can say the virulence of the pathogen is sometimes higher in certain cases, and the pathology of the disease is sometimes related to this virulence of these pathogens, virulence factor of these pathogens. So first of all, we are talking about bacteria, because bacteria are those microorganisms, they have multi-faces. Why? Because they opt different mechanisms so that they can escape from the immune defense system of the host. However, they can employ different tactics. For example, they will modulate the cell surface. That means they will change the antigenic structures that are present on their cell membrane, or they can release certain products, certain proteins, so that they either can inhibit or degrade the host immune factors. Or sometimes they produce such kind of proteins that have similar structure to that of the host immune cells, or you can say self antigens. So basically, they sometimes undergo the property of mimicking also. So because of these camouflaging factors imposed by these bacteria and different pathogens, the precise weaponry technique of by these bacterial pathogens, they have significantly contributed the in evading strategies that are opted by these pathogenic bacteria so as to evade the host mechanism. So what are the strategies in detail? We'll be talking about that. So the first strategy is immunological tolerance to a bacterial antigen. Next one is antigenic disguise, immunosuppression, persistence of a pathogen at those sites which are inaccessible to our specific immune responses. Then induction of ineffective antibody, because now the strategy is being targeted towards the humoral system, because in our humoral system, B cells are able to produce antibodies. So if they can induce the production of such kind of antibody that is ineffective against them, so they can evade the host immune system. Then there is a strategy in which the antibodies produced by the host cells, they are absorbed by the soluble bacterial antigen. or there is some local interference with the antibody activity. And the last strategy is antigenic variation. So we'll be discussing one by one all these strategies. The first thing is immunological tolerance to a bacterial antigen. First of all, we need to understand the meaning of tolerance. What is tolerance? So in a layman language, we normally say tolerance, basically it is the ability that to which extent a particular organism can resist a particular thing. For example, now in the context of immunology, this tolerance is basically it is a property of host in which there is some significant immunological reduction in the immune response to given antigen. That means our immune system have different tolerance layers. So in case the tolerance to a particular bacterial antigen, that means it corresponds to a particular deficiency in accordance to the specific antigens present in the bacteria. So in case a person is having some depressed immune response to a particular kind of antigen that is present on the bacteria, in that case, because of the depressed immune system, those antigens will be tolerated by our immune system and the infection would be facilitated. So the tolerance to an antigen, it can arise in a number of ways. Numerous ways are available, of which due to which various bacterial infections sometimes develop. So the first is fetal exposure to antigen. Now this context, this point is basically if a fetus is infected at certain ages of immunological development, because the fetus is basically undergoing development. In that case, the immunological defense mechanisms, they are in the developmental stages. So if a fetus, if it gets infected by a particular pathogen, at that developmental stages, that means at that time, the immune system was not strong. It was weak. It was in the depressed state because the complete development was not there. In that case, if a fetus happens to get an infection, that microbial antigen at that developmental stages will be recognized as self, because the body of the fetus is in developing stages. Because of that, they won't be able to differentiate between self and non-self. The microbial antigens present, they will be recognizing those antigens as self material. Because of that self material, the tolerance would be induced. Because of that, our immune response against that bacterial infection won't be coming. So a fetus would be having a particular bacterial infection, or they would be more susceptible to those bacterial infection, because the body will recognize every time if that bacterial infection is happening, the body will recognize those antigens as self. Another is high persistent dose of circulating antigens. Sometimes the tolerance to a particular bacteria or one of its products, it can be toxins, it can be proteins, they sometimes arise when large amount of bacterial antigens, they are they are present in the circulation of the host. In that case, the immunological systems becomes overwhelmed because of the large number of antigen. Due to the high dose of circulating antigen, the tolerance to that bacterial antigen is achieved. Third condition is molecular mimicry. As the name suggests, mimicry, that means a particular bacterial antigen will have the similar structure to that of self antigen. Now, because we are talking about antigens, that is why we are saying molecular mimicry. So if a particular bacterial antigen is very similar to the normal host antigen, in that case, the immune response will get confused. The immune cells will get confused. They will recognize those bacterial antigens as self-material because of the resemblance between the bacterial antigen and this host antigen. So this resemblance part, this type of mechanism is known as molecular mimicry. There are many examples to it. For example, some of the bacteria, they have some capsules that are composed of certain polysaccharides in which, for example, hyaluronic acid is there, sialic acid is there. Those polysaccharides, they are so similar to the host tissue polysaccharides that sometimes host tissue recognize those bacteria as self because of the presence of polysaccharides. And in that case, the tolerance condition is achieved. In some times, as I told you, that the you know these bacteria and pathogens, they use many tactics to escape from the immune system, from to escape from the immune response, in which the first thing is modulation of the outermost layer, or you can say cell wall modification, some capsule production, and some mimicry technique. All these things would be covered in it. Now, the cell wall of bacterial pathogen. So, whenever suppose if a particular person is being infected by a particular pathogen, in that case, the first thing that interact with the human immune system is cell membrane. That means the outermost covering. So, the cell wall of bacterial pathogen is the first target of human immune cells. Because if you are trying to kill a particular pathogen at that time, the first thing the immune cells will be first encountering with the cell wall. Now, in case if the cell wall is modified or the structure is modified, in that case, what will happen? In that case, our immune cells won't be able to act on those bacteria. However, in the normal condition, what happens is our immune system act on the cell wall. In that case, you can use certain antibiotics or some antibacterial peptides so as to neutralize, so as to trigger the neutralization of bacteria. If this outermost layer is modified, your host immune, the host immune system won't be able to recognize it. However, there are many examples to it. For example, in the case of E. coli, in case of S. enterica, and some other gram-negative organisms, in which the basic mechanism of escaping the host immune response is acylation of the lipid A component of the LPS in the cell walls. That means in the cell wall, the LPS molecule, there is a lipid molecule named as lipid A component. They basically undergo acylation of that, so that their negatively charged surface is changed to positively charged because of this acylation process. So because of this process, bacterial cell, because now they have acquired positive charge, so they will repel the positively charged antimicrobial peptides produced by the host immune cells. Because our host immune cells, what strategy they would be using? They will be either producing some antibodies, they will be either producing some peptides so as to neutralize that bacteria. But those peptides are positively charged. Now the bacterial cell has changed its cell wall and it has changed its charge. Because of that, as you know, the same charges repel each other and the opposite ones attract each other. So, because of the positive charge, both of these things will repel each other. Because of this condition, the complete, due to the masking of these negatively charged cell surface, the bacteria would be protected from the host immune cells. However, this mechanism of masking and changing the charge, it is not only unique to the gram-negative bacteria. There are many gram-positive pathogens also. For example, S. aureus is there, Listeria is there. They also reduce the negative charge of the cell wall teichoic acid by de-alanylation. So this is the diagram actually for which I have explained all these things. But as you can see, this is a gram-negative bacteria. This is the DNA part. This is the flagella. This is the outer membrane and inner membrane. In this case, what is happening, if you enlarge this thing, this is divided into these three regions. As you can see, LPS, this is the periplasm and inner membrane. Now, in this case, you can see these are polysaccharides, phospholipids, lipoproteins, peptidoglycans. In this case, this component is known as lipid A. If you enlarge this lipid A component, the structure is like this. In this case, this lipid A is basically acylated. Because of that, the complete outermost layer is changed. Another mechanism is antigenic disguise. There is a mechanism, basically, there are some pathogens that they hide their unique antigenic determinants from the opsonizing antibodies or complement proteins. First of all, what are opsonizing antibodies? Those antibodies that have the property to trigger or to change the path of antigen to the phagocytosis. That means they basically proceed with the process of phagocytosis. There are some complement proteins and there are some antibodies also. So those antibodies which target the antigen to the phagocytic cells, those are known as opsonins. or opsonizing antibodies. So sometimes what happens, bacteria or some pathogens, what they do, they coat their surface with the host protein. Now if they have coated their surface with host protein, the host immune cells or the antibodies or complement proteins won't be able to recognize that bacteria because the surface is coated with the self proteins. It can be fibrin, it can be fibronectin, there can be some immunoglobulin molecules also. In this way, they basically, you know, try to act smart so that, you know, the immune cells get confused and they recognize those things as foreign, they recognize those things as self, and because of that, they won't be attacking against those bacteria. So they basically hide their own antigenic surface from the immunological system. However, this complete strategy is being opted by different kind of pathogens. For example, S. aureus, that is Staphylococcus aureus, it produces some cell wall bound coagulase and clumping factor. Because of that, the fibrin is clotted and it get deposited onto the cell surface of Staphylococcus aureus. And they get protected, and you can say they get escaped from the immunological mechanisms. However, there is another protein produced by Streptococcus pyogenes. It produces a protein named as protein G. The main function of this protein G is to bind with the Fc portion of immunoglobulin. And when it binds, it basically coat the bacteria with these protein molecules that are bound with the antibody. Because of that, the coating the bacteria with antibodies, because of that, the opsonization process will be disrupted. Another is in case of Trypanoma pallidum, in which the fibronectin molecules, they provide an immunological disguise. In case of E. coli K1, that normally, you know, is a causative agent of meningitis. In case of newborns, they sometimes have a capsule composed of sialic acid. And in the previous slide also, I told you that there are some host polysaccharides who are, you know, which are similar in structure with the bacterial surface lipopolysaccharide. So because of this, they create a condition of antigenic disguise. Next mechanism is immunosuppression. However, as the name suggests, immunosuppression, that means a condition in which the immune mechanisms of the host would be suppressed. That means those pathogens will act in such a manner that they will cause the immunosuppression in the infected host. Or you can say these immunosuppression systems are normally observed in the case of chronic bacterial infections such as tuberculosis, leprosy. However, it has been considered that around 1/3 of the world population is, you know, infected with this mycobacterium tuberculosis, because the main mechanism of action of this bacteria is immunosuppression. However, there are different stages of these infections, that some cases are mild, some cases are very severe. In that case, this either in the case of leprosy, if Mycobacterium leprae is involved, in that case some unique antigens of this bacteria are associated with the cause of immunosuppression. However, this complete thing is dependent upon three main points, that is lack of co-stimulatory signals that are required for the cytokine secretion by T helper 2 cells. This is the first point. Second point, activation of suppressor T cells. That means those T cells who would be suppressing the effect of suppressing the activity of effector T cells. And the third one is disturbance in the T helper 1 and T helper 2 cell activity. So because of that, the complete immune response coming from T cells, that would be obstructed. Next is persistence of a pathogen at bodily sites inaccessible to specific immune response. First of all, the name of this mechanism says it all. That means persistence of a pathogen. That means pathogen is residing at those sites are inaccessible to the specific immune response. That means from the cells of immune system. That means pathogen will hide themselves at those sites in the immune body on which the immune cells won't be able to act, or those sites are inaccessible. So in that case, many intracellular pathogens are the major key players by using this strategy. these intracellular pathogens, they can evade the host immunological responses as long as they stay inside the infected cell and they do not allow the microbial antigen to form on the cell surface. That means they do not allow the microbial antigen to express on the cell surface so that it can be recognized by T cells. So this type of mechanism is normally observed in the case of bacterial infection in which macrophages, that means the phagocytic cell, in which the complete processing is happening, then the presentation is happening and phagocytosis is happening. This is mainly seen in these macrophages in which the main causal pathogens are Brucella, Listeria and Mycobacterium leprae. However, in this case, these cells, these macrophages, they support the growth of this bacteria. Or at the same time, they also give protection from the immune response. That means bacteria is playing very smart and it is basically, you know, using these macrophages for their survival. On the other hand, it is also seeking protection by protection from the immune responses of the host. However, there are many more examples also. For example, Yersinia, Shigella, Listeria, E. coli, they also take such kind of mechanism in which they get deposited in those cells which are not accessible to either phagocytes or to antigen presenting cells. However, some of the pathogens, they are also present on the luminal surface of gastrointestinal tract, oral cavity, urinary tract, or in the lumen of the salivary glands, mammary glands, or the kidney tubule. In case if there is no host cell destruction, the pathogen is basically avoiding the inflammatory response because there is no other way in which sensitized lymphocytes or circulating antibodies can reach the site to eliminate the infection. Because what happens is whenever you get some infection, in that case certain symptoms develop. But in this case, bacteria, basically it doesn't attack host cell. It remains in the quiescent stage, or you can say inactivated stage. So when the situation comes, or you can say when the immune system is weak, at that time they cause the infection. So in this case, when the bacteria is not inducing any inflammatory response, or it is not causing any host cell destruction, in that case the circulating lymphocytes are immunosurveillance cells, are antibodies, they won't be reaching to the site at which the pathogen is present. However, there is only one immunoglobulin, that is secretory immunoglobulin A, that is normally released in the secretion. So this secretory immunoglobulin A, it can react with the surface antigens on the bacterial cells. But the complement sequence, the complete cascade of complement proteins won't be activated. Because of that, the cells of the bacteria won't be destroyed or won't be killed. However, these IgA antibodies are sometimes also called immobilization of the bacteria by agglutination of cells, or some, you know, by blocking the adhesion mechanism of bacteria to the tissues or the cell surfaces. However, they do not, cause the lysis of these cells or inhibit their growth, but they try to block their further, spread. So these are the few examples, that is Streptococcus mutans. It can initiate dental caries at any time after the eruption of teeth, regardless of the immune status of the host. That means this bacteria, it resides in the tissues in quiescent stage. Another is Vibrio cholerae. It also multiplies in the gastrointestinal tract, where the bacteria elaborate a toxin. It produces a toxin molecule, which is basically responsible for the excess secretion of the fluids and ultimately leading to the diarrhea in the host, which is the main characteristic feature of the disease cholera. However, in this case, the IgA antibodies produced against the cellular antigen of this bacteria are not completely effective. That means the antibodies, the IgA antibody that is produced against this bacteria, it is inefficient in preventing the infection. Because of that, that is why these cholera disease was so much, severe, was found to be so much severe. Now the another point is Salmonella typhi. However, there is a carrier state of typhoid fever that normally happens due to some persistent infection by the typhoid bacillus, that is Salmonella typhi. The organism this organism, this bacteria, is actually not completely eliminated during the initial infection. Suppose a person is for the first time it got infected, in that time it is you have taken the medication and now you are well. But the point is, does this thing mean that you will be immune to the further infections, or there would be no recurrent infections? No, because the organism is not eliminated completely from the body. However, it can reside inside the host cells and tissues for months, years, or for a lifetime. That means this bacteria will again come into action whenever the situation is ripe for their growth or ripe to cause the infection. However, there are many bacteria that cause persistent infections in the lumen of glands, for example, Brucella, that normally infects the mammary glands of the cows. However, it also produces certain kind of toxins in the milk also. Similarly, these bacteria, there are many bacteria that cause infections of hair follicles, for example, acne. And they seldom, face any kind of immunological response against them. This is basically due to this strategy. Another is induction of ineffective antibody. Now, as the name suggests, such type of antibody would be produced, which would be not at all effective against that pathogen. That means many type of antibodies are formed whenever a particular antigen try to evade the host immune system. In that case, many different types of antibodies are formed, and some bacterial components, they sometimes display many antigenic determinants. So against many antigenic determinants, many antibodies would be released. If antibodies formed against bacterial antigens are of low avidity or low affinity, or if they are directed against such kind of antigenic determinant which is not of much importance, in that case, a very weak bacterial antibacterial action or antibacterial immunological response is mounted. So such ineffective or non-neutralizing antibodies, they basically aid the pathogen to increase surface antigen, or by blocking the attachment of any functional antibody onto the bacterial sample. In the case of Neisseria gonorrhoeae, in which the presence of antibody to an outer membrane known as RMP, it basically interferes with the bacterial sudden reaction. So that is why the surface of, you can say, the mucosal surface of female urinary tract is compromised because of that, and that there is an increased risk of infection. Next strategy is antibodies that are absorbed by soluble bacterial antigens. That means some bacteria, they have the capability to liberate such kind of antigenic surface components that, first of all, they are present in a soluble form. That means those antigens are soluble in the tissue fluids. So these soluble antigens are able to combine with the antibodies that are produced against them. And after combining with, they neutralize those antibodies before they reach the bacterial cells. That means from the bacteria, these antigens would be released in the fluids. In the fluids, our immune cells would be producing antibody. Antibodies would be combining with those antigens in the fluid part, and in the fluid part they would be neutralized by these soluble antigens, and the antibodies that were produced, they won't be able to reach the site where the bacterial infection was there, so that they can clear it out. So because of that, the antibody absorption is happening by the soluble antigens of such type, and because of that, the bacterial infection won't be cleared from the body and it will remain inside. However, for example, small amount of endotoxin, it is released in the surrounding fluids by gram-negative bacteria. However, in the case of autolysis of gram-negative and gram-positive bacteria, they also release certain antigenic surface components in a soluble form. For example, Streptococcus pneumoniae, Neisseria, they are known to release some capsular polysaccharides while growing inside the tissues. So because of those polysaccharides, the antibodies targeted against them, they are neutralized by these polysaccharides. However, these polysaccharides are also found in the serum of patients with pneumococcal pneumonia or in the cerebrospinal fluid of the patients with meningitis. However, these release surface antigens, they are acting as a mopping agent. That means they mop up the antibody before it reaches to the site of infection, so as to, you know, control the infection there, to have the control on those infective areas. So another example is protein A that is produced by a bacteria S. aureus, and it remain bound to the staphylococcal cell surface, or sometimes it get released into the tissue fluids. Against antibody produced against this protein A would be neutralized, and because of that, the bacterial infection will persist inside the body. Another is local interference with the antibody activity. The point is, there are many ways that pathogens interferes with the antibacterial action of the antibody molecules. Some pathogens, they produce certain enzymes that destroy these antibodies. If the antibodies targeted against a particular bacteria is destroyed, so how they will be, you know, cleared from the body? So in this case, the enzymes produced by these bacteria, these pathogens, they are basically providing them or protecting them from immunological responses. This thing is mainly happening in the case of Neisseria meningitis, Haemophilus influenzae, Streptococcus pneumoniae. In this case, this grow on the surface of the body and they produce IgA proteases. As the name suggests, IgA protease. That means the antibody on which they will be acting upon is IgA. Proteases means those enzymes that have the proteolytic action. That means they have the capability to degrade any proteinaceous thing. So these enzymes will degrade the secretory immunoglobulin A, and by cleaving at the hinge region, because of that, Fc region and Fab region is completely separated and the antibody is inactivated. Basically, the interference in the antibody activity is happening. Last is antigenic variation. As the name suggests, that means the bacteria will use certain mechanism in which the main antigenic determinant, it will change. That as you must have heard in the case of COVID also, first of all, it was reported that there is some receptor present onto the surface of this COVID. And after that, it was reported there is a mutant strain in the market who is more severe, who is more virulent as compared to the previous one, because the virus has changed its morphology. Basically, the virus has undergone the mechanism of antigenic variation. That means this way basically used to trick the forces of immunological responses, you know, to move them to, or you can say to lead them to a false way. So because of that, they periodically keep on changing the antigens that are present onto the surface. Because of this condition, this is known as antigen variation. So antigenic variation, it is however a very important mechanism that is undergone by many pathogenic organisms, whether it is bacteria or it is fungi, so that they can escape from the neutralizing activity of the antibodies. In the case of Neisseria gonorrhoeae, this procedure is being operated in which they change the febrile antigens during the course of infection. During the initial stages, they adhere to the epithelial cell, and the urethra is mediated by the pili. However, because of the rapid switching on and off condition of these genes controlling the pili formation, at the different stages of infection, this bacteria is capable of undergoing this type of pili switching or phase variation. Because of this phase variation, they get protection. So these are some immune evasion mechanisms that are used by viruses, along with examples. For example, antigenic variation in place of influenza virus, HIV virus, rhinovirus. In this case, what is happening, suppose this is an influenza virus, onto the surface, as you can see, these are few antigenic determinants that have been, you know, marked in red and blue, heme agglutinin and neuraminidase. This is the nucleocapsid. So in the normal condition, the antigenic drift is happening in which the virus is attaching to the host cell to cause the infection. But in case of human influenza, so if you are using a particular kind of antibody, in that case, this particular antibody will cause the mechanism of antigenic drift. But in case of these diseases, when they undergo antigenic variation, they undergo the mechanism of antigenic shift. And because of that, the infection is severe. So this is a new influenza virus strain that is basically happening due to the antigenic shift because of the change in the cell surface antigens. Suppose human influenza virus and avian influenza virus characteristics would be combined in one strain. Another mechanism is inhibition of antigen processing. This thing That means whenever you got some infection, in that case, the antigen is basically processed by certain phagocytic cells, by receptor-mediated endocytosis. After that, they get processed through proteasome. From those, the protein fragments are presented by the MHC molecule onto the cell surface. Then those things are recognized by the T helper cell. T helper cell secrete cytokines. Then cytokines, they activate B cells so that the antibody is produced. But in case this antigen processing and presentation pathway is sometimes defective, or it is interrupted, or it is being interfered by certain virus mechanism, in that case the complete processing, presentation and their neutralization won't be happening. So in case of this, some viruses use the mechanism that they inhibit this antigen processing stage. And they do that by two things. That is blockage of TAP transporter. This TAP transporter is basically present in the endoplasmic reticulum. And this thing is being followed by herpes simplex virus. I shall be discussing this thing in detail also in the coming slide. Next is removal of class 1 molecules from the endoplasmic reticulum, because all the processed antigens, they are basically processed by, they are presented by MHC class 1 molecules. So if that class 1 MHC molecules are removed from the circulation, in that case, it won't be able to present onto the cell surface. It won't be recognized by the cells of the immune system. This mechanism is used by cytomegalovirus. Another is production of decoy MHC molecules to inhibit NK cells. That means those MHC cell molecules are basically being produced that can give false signal to natural killer cells, so that the immune cells don't get activated. So in this case, the example is cytomegalovirus. However, there is another mechanism also. But before that, we shall be discussing the mechanism by which viruses inhibit antigen processing and presentation. As in the case I told you, blockage of TAP transporter. So basically, in normal pathway, this is the pathway. This is a cytosolic protein, or you can say an antigenic protein. This is a proteasome. It is a protein complex that is basically involved in the processing of these antigens. What happens is, this is a cylindrical shaped proteasome onto which the proteins are entered. And they are degraded into small peptides. As you can see here, these brown ones, these are small peptides. So these small antigenic peptides then enter the endoplasmic reticulum. This is ER, that is written as ER. So if they basically enter inside this endoplasmic reticulum by this TAP transporter, this TAP is transporter associated protein. So if we block the transport, that means here it is written block in the TAP transport, the virus is HSV. If you inhibit the proteasome processing, in that case also the complete antigen processing is blocked. So this basically happens in the case of EBV and human cytomegalovirus. Second is, if you can block the entry inside the endoplasmic reticulum. So when these proteins enter inside the endoplasmic reticulum, this structure, yellow one, written in somewhat in M shape, it is representing class 1 MHC molecules. On this class 1 MHC molecule, these proteins are bind, and from there it get transported in the form of vesicle to the cell surface. As you can see, this is a vesicle in which this class 1 molecule carrying the peptide, it is being presented onto the cell surface. Here it is recognized by cytotoxic T lymphocyte, and so that its killing can be triggered. On the other hand, the unused, this virus particle is then recognized by natural killer cell. So at different stages of this processing, different viruses act. As you can see, block in the TAP transporter was herpes simplex virus. If you block the synthesis of MHC molecule, if MHC molecules are not there, who will be presenting the peptides? This is done by adenovirus and human cytomegalovirus. Another one is, if you remove the class 1 MHC molecule from endoplasmic reticulum, in that case also the antigens won't be able to be present on the surface. Cytomegalovirus again uses this mechanism. Last is engagement of NK cell inhibitory receptor by decoy viral class 1 molecules. That means these some viral particles, they will be basically falsifying the NK cells. They will be confusing the NK cells. Yes, these are the MHC molecules, but those are not. That means they are basically mimicking it. So in case of murine cytomegalovirus, this process happens. The last stage is production of cytokine receptor homologs. That means certain receptors are produced by the different viruses, which have similar structure to the various cytokines that are released by T helper cells. So this happens in the case of vaccinia, pox virus, and cytomegalovirus. Another is production of immunosuppressive cytokines. It happens in the case of Epstein-Barr virus. Infection and death of functional impairment of immune cells. That means the complete immune cells, or whether it is B cell or T cells, their function is interrupted or impaired. It happens in the case of HIV. Then complement activation pathway. Then that means all the three pathways of complement, classical, alternative, and lectin, all of these pathways are basically inhibited at the various stages, either the recruitment of factor H or by the incorporation of CD59 marker in the viral envelope. This is also happening in the case of HIV, vaccinia, and human cytomegalovirus. However, next is inhibition of innate immunity. That is the natural immunity. In that case, what happens is all the RNA molecules, all the RNA, viral RNA that is entered inside the immune cells, in that case, they inhibit the activity of RAG1 protein. Because of that, the infection will persist. This is normally the strategy opted by vaccinia and HIV. However, there is another mechanism of inhibition of PKR, that is proteinase K receptor signaling, by IFN, interferon receptor. So this is also a strategy used by HIV, HCV, hepatitis C virus, herpes simplex virus, and polio. So these are the few further links on which you can further read this topic in detail, and the book reference is QPE Immunology. These are the few MCQs pertaining to this lecture, which is already uploaded on the LMS. You people can have a look there. Thank you so much for listening. In the next lecture, we will be talking about different immune evasion mechanisms, opted by virus in detail, by fungus in detail, and other bacterial pathogens in detail, one by one, with proper examples. Thank you so much for listening.